In this video series, we're going to be discussing the complex and, for some people, emotional question of what gender is. But before I even start talking about what we'll be covering in this unit, I have to be clear about what these videos are for. They're an exploration of current and historical psychological theories of gender, primarily designed to cover what is required on the AQA A-level specification. I know some people come to my channel for other reasons, but please keep in mind that what I'll be discussing here isn't my own opinions. I'll be covering established theories and evaluations of those theories. Whatever your personal beliefs, you're likely to find something in this set of videos that offends you. In fact, I would be surprised if you didn't. I'm looking at you, Freud. The main point is, some people may be coming here to understand themselves a little better, and that is fine. I hope these videos help you on your journey. They won't have all the answers. But people with a range of beliefs on gender will find things they agree with and disagree with here. I'll try and cover all of this in a respectful way, and I'd expect the same in the comment section. So while I'm happy for you to discuss the details of what you hear, please keep what you say respectful to whoever might be reading. So, what's in the unit? First, we'll discuss what the differences are between the terms sex and gender, and how psychologists even try to define someone's gender. We'll then spend a video looking at biological explanations for gender development, including some interesting variations on the typical male XX and female XY chromosome pattern. We'll then explain gender development with three competing perspectives. In the Cognitive Explanation, Kohlberg will explain how an understanding of gender develops as we mature and become aware of our own and other people's gender. Freud will explain gender development as due to early interactions with our mothers and fathers, ultimately identifying with and imitating the same-sex parent. And finally, social learning theorists will suggest that we develop our gendered behaviours through seeing others praised for sex-appropriate gender behaviour, or being praised ourselves. And finally, we will consider atypical gender development, examining the theories that attempt to explain why some people experience a mismatch between their sex and their gender. So let's get started. PsychBoost.com, over 170 videos to help you with your qualification, and Patreon supporters can access bonus resources, tutorial videos, and the Discord channel. Sex and gender. When talking about sex and gender, it's easy to get confused about which term is correct for a particular context. When psychologists use the term sex, what they mean is the biological differences between males and females. Now, this is both the genetic differences and the anatomical differences. So this means that biological sex is assigned to someone at the moment of conception, and this is due to inheriting either an XX sex chromosome for females or XY sex chromosome for males. But sex is actually assigned at birth. Now, keep in mind that this definition for sex will come a little more blurry when discussing atypical sex chromosomes, and we'll discuss those in the next video, when we come to biological explanations. When psychologists use the term gender, they're referring to behavioural differences, distinguishing between what are thought to be typical masculine and feminine personality traits. Here is a short list of traits that are often considered masculine and feminine. But an important point to make right away is this means someone's gender identity may not necessarily match what is traditionally expected from their biological sex. When we think of the set of behaviours that are expected from males and females in society, this is what we call a sex role stereotype. This is a set of expected behaviours that can vary significantly between cultures. But within our own culture, we use a set of shared sex role stereotypes to predict other people's behaviour and decide how to behave ourselves. Now, you might be sitting there thinking, well, I don't have any sex role stereotypes. But we all do. Here's an example. I personally don't feel like I'm particularly concerned with being seen as a masculine man. I'm not interested in football or other stereotypical manly interests. But when picking my outfit for class, I am gonna pick a suit, not a dress. Now, that's not because I think there are any problems at all with anyone who identifies as male or female deciding to wear a dress. But there are a few reasons why I personally wouldn't pick a dress. And one of the main reasons is because I'm aware everybody I interact with that day has a very strong set of sex role stereotypes. Expectations that I would have completely broken. Dresses are just not an expected uniform for male teachers. Now, some people, perhaps yourself, would react positively, some negatively, but that is not the point. The point is everyone will react. If I turned up in a dress, I'd have to spend all day talking to people about why I've decided to wear what I've had. But if I turned up for class as usual, in my suit, obviously no one's going to think twice. Now, the psychological process we go through to develop these sex role stereotypes is dependent on your psychological perspective. I won't go into more detail here, as when we cover cognitive, social learning theory, and psychodynamics, we're going to be discussing different arguments for the development of sex role stereotypes. But to be clear, when classifying someone's gender, we would argue that someone is feminine if they have a large number and strongly expressed feminine traits, and so masculine if they have a high level of masculine traits. Simple so far. But what if someone has high levels of masculine and feminine traits, but this is balanced between the two? Well, we would call those people androgynous. And examples of famous androgynous celebrities are David Bowie, Lady Gaga, and Johnny Depp. Now, there is one more option. If someone has a few strong traits of either gender, in this case, they would be called undifferentiated. Sandra Bem developed a way to measure gender using Bem Sex Role Inventory. This is a 60-question questionnaire that asks you to rate yourself out of 7 on a range of personality traits. Of those 60 traits, 20 are thought to be masculine, 20 feminine, and the final 20 are neutral. So from your responses, you can be scored on two dimensions, masculine and feminine. Now, Bem argued that androgynous people, those with high balanced masculine-feminine traits, are more psychologically healthy than other types. Evaluations. Let's consider Bem's own research as evaluative evidence for gender. She measured 561 males and 356 females using the BSRI, finding that perhaps unsurprisingly, most males were sex-typed with masculine personality types, and most females were sex-typed with feminine personality types. So this provides evidence for the concept of distinct sets of sex-typical gendered personality traits. But Bem also provides evidence in the study for androgyny, with 34% of males and 27% of females classified as androgynous. But one issue with Bem's original study was she didn't include a category for people with few feminine or masculine traits, but she did later update her model to include undifferentiated. Now, Bem did claim that androgynous people were better adapted. Is there any evidence for that? Adams and Shearer used the BSRI on 101 university students alongside some other personality tests. What they actually found was that the more masculine males and females appeared to be best adjusted on a range of measures, including assertiveness and self-efficacy. Now, obviously, that counters Bem's theory. But let's think about this a little deeper. Maybe the reason for this finding is we live in a male-dominated society, and because of this, it's highly competitive. In a world like this, assertiveness is helpful. But if we lived in a more equal society, perhaps an androgynous personality type would be more beneficial. Now that was two research evaluations. I'm going to give a few evaluations of Bem's work here, partly because it gives me the chance to talk about some research methods concepts I want to make sure you're really familiar with. But you may not want to memorise all of this. Perhaps keep the ones that you feel you can express best in an exam. Firstly, if you give the BSRI to people multiple times, they tend to get the same score. This is test-retest reliability. This both suggests the BSRI is accurately measuring gender and gender is stable over time. But there is the issue of temporal validity. Looking at some of Bem's traits, we might not agree with some of them because of changes in society and our understanding of social roles. After all, childlike and gullible are two traits that Bem assigned to feminine. But a significant positive of Bem's work is it did help to establish that gender identity is separate from and can be different to biological sex. This and positive promotion of androgyny might have had positive effects on society, leading to less discrimination of people who lead non-gender normative lives. but it could be argued that a BSRI score vastly oversimplifies someone's experience of their own gender. We'll often change how we act depending on the context and who we're with, perhaps being more masculine when with workmates or in formal occasions, but more feminine when spending time with family members. And finally, the BSRI was created using Western students. This sampling bias means it might have limited generalizability to older age groups or other cultures. And finally, as sex role stereotypes is mentioned here on the specification, I'm going to mention some evaluations. These evaluations appear again when we get into other sections of the unit, but if you're planning an essay in this area and you're asked to evaluate sex role stereotypes, these are going to help. Smith and Lloyd got 32 mothers who had recently had their own first child to be participants and told them they were doing a study investigating play. Then they introduced them to a stranger's six-month-old baby and asked them to simply play with the baby for 10 minutes in a room with a selection of toys. The researchers recorded the participant playing with the baby from a hidden camera. Now the babies used were either biologically male or female, and they were either given sex-appropriate names and clothes, or they were given cross-sex names and clothes. So, half the time the mothers were playing with babies that were dressed and named in a way that made them think they were the opposite sex. And I think you can guess what the researchers found. When measuring first toy choice, the masculine, squeaky toy hammer, was only ever given to the babies dressed as males. And the feminine, doll, was only given as a first toy choice to babies dressed as females. So the infants were being encouraged to immediately play with gender-appropriate toys. Not only that, but the researchers assessed how the babies were encouraged in their play. And what they found was the babies dressed as boys were given significantly more encouragement for large physical actions like attempting to crawl or walk. This shows that even as infants, boys are encouraged to be more athletic and be more confident in taking risks. So that's pretty good evidence that the mother's play style is being shaped by her sex role stereotypes. There's actually a BBC clip of a kind of similar replication of this study, and you can see it on YouTube. I'll leave a link. Going in a completely different research direction is Mead. In the 1930s, her work with tribal communities around the world gave a view into groups of people whose cultures had developed in complete isolation. In New Guinea, three communities had very unusual gender roles. In the Mundugama tribe, both genders were highly aggressive and competitive, traits usually associated with masculinity. The Arapesh had males and females showing feminine caring behaviour. And the Chambuli tribe had completely reversed gender roles. This culture expected females to show leadership and dominance while males were passive, emotional and responsible for child rearing. The fact that human communities can vary so radically suggests that gender stereotypes do exist, that gender roles are a product of culture and learnt via socialisation, and what we see as male and female behaviour is not a fundamental biological process. Now, we could consider if sex role stereotypes is now lacking temporal validity. Ideas have changed, and cultural changes in society around the roles males and females has influenced child rearing, with children not as expected to perform sex-type behaviours, in addition to gender-neutral clothes and toys being more common. So it might be that the theory of sex role stereotypes is becoming less relevant. And a last point. There's clearly still gender-based discrimination in society. People who hold strong stereotypical expectations of gendered behaviour may decide to hire or not hire someone on the basis of expectations that are biased in favour of one gender or another. Psychological research resulting in a deeper understanding of the origins and development of gender might help counter this kind of discrimination. Here is a real gender exam question on 2018 on Ben's research. Give it a go and see how you do. I want to thank everyone who supported this channel over on Patreon during the development of the gender unit. You help make the development of these free A-level videos possible. If you're a Psych Boost patron at the neuron level and above, you can access 6 bonus gender tutorial videos over on psychboost.com. In them, I'll talk you through a model answer for the exam questions, and I'll talk you through some general exam tips based on the exam reports. But for everybody else, don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss the videos released right up to your exams. And I'll see you in the next Psych Boost video.